like Harold normally says. Beautiful morning for us to get around and look. How about I will tell this wondrous story, 468. I will sing the wondrous story, so we've got to sing it standing up. 468.
Through the announcements. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for another beautiful day here this fall. We thank you for the blessings you bestowed upon each and every one of us this week, and we ask, Lord, that you'd please be with those that are traveling over to Seedline, Pastor and Diane and the others, and let them have a wonderful couple of days over there, and come back rejuvenated and telling us some great stories. We ask, Lord, that you be with the people that are sick today, those that are hurting and suffering, whether it be physical or emotional. Hopefully they'll find grace and peace and comfort through you, Lord. Lord, if there's one here today that doesn't know you as their Savior, I hope today's the day they ask you in their heart. Thank you for all you've done for us, Lord, and we ask all these things in thy Son's name. Amen. Amen. All right, well, I'm up again. It seems like I was just up here a couple weeks ago, but Pastor and a couple others have went over to Seedline. I'd like to do that myself sometime, but I haven't been able to do it so far. How many of you have been over to Seedline? Anyone in here? A couple? And I know, isn't Brother Kistler from Washington, D.C. over there for the next couple of days?
He's speaking.
I know when he's been here for our revival and stuff, he's been awesome. I love listening to him, but I like hearing about history and the politics, and he knows all about that. He's been in Washington, D.C., trying to fight for the Lord in the middle of the swamp.
Amen.
So to speak. All right, many thanks to all who supported the Hands Across the Border of Mexico mission with clothing and household items and backpack donations. We ask that you pray for Journey's mercy for our church members who are traveling back and forth to Seedline over the next few days. The Pastor Appreciation Luncheon will be held on Sunday, October 23rd, following the morning service. Please bring a covered dish. There will be no evening service. Calvary's Love Music Ministry will be with us on Sunday, October 30th, during the morning service. And the church family potluck dinner and Thanksgiving service is scheduled for Wednesday, November 16th at 6 p.m. Please plan to be with us. Also, in the back is a benevolent fund. If you have a dollar to drop in that at the way out, please do that. And I think at this time, I'm going to ask my former Sunday school teacher, Kathleen Rittenauer, to come up and do our scripture. I think I was 11 when she was my Sunday school teacher.
I hope he learned something, I'm sure. I know he learned something. I know he learned something. I'm proud of him. There's a song that the Gaithers sing, they wrote, and it's called Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name.
Amen.
So I'm reading today from Philippians chapter 2, 9 through 11. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
I was talking to a couple ladies this morning about a singer that I just found, Mark Bishop. I don't know how many of you have heard of him, but so I went searching on the internet and I found a song that he sang, and it was He Loved Me From the Cross. And while he was singing the song, they showed Christ carrying this cross. He was already beaten so bad you couldn't recognize him, and he fell, and you know how it is, they made him keep carry the cross, and then all the way to the hill, and then as they nailed him down, and I'm sitting there watching this, and I didn't have tears come to my eyes. I bawled, you know, to think that, you know, 2,200 years ago, whatever, he did that for me, you know. He was thinking about me when this was all going on. And you think, would you want that to happen to one of your family? But he is. He's part of my family. So when I think what happened to him, it just tears your heart out. But if he didn't, where would we be? Where would we be? You know, we're not perfect. Lord knows, like our pastor says, we sin every day. Every day we come short of the glory of God. We've all sinned. And I remember when I go to bed at night, Lord, sometimes all I can say is, Lord, just have mercy. Because I can't enumerate the things that I, you know. But you know, he did that. And it says in what John, one of the Johns, I love him because he first loved me. And that's the way I want us all to be. I want them to think of what he did and then love him for that. Not because you're afraid of him. Not because you're afraid of something that he's going to do to you sometime. But because of the wonderful things that he's done for you. And look around you this morning. Oh, he hasn't stopped yet. And our minds cannot fathom what is he going to have for us. Well, first thing I want to do, I want to hug my son when I get there. You know? And then I want to look in Jesus' eyes. Let's just say thanks. Thanks. Because what can you say? What can you say? No words can express it. But you know, sometimes I worry about my faith. Sometimes I worry, you know, do I really have it right? But then when I see something like that and it tears my heart out, then I know that he's in there. And that Holy Spirit is just, oh, he's working with me, you know. And if you can watch that and not have your heart torn out, but there's something wrong with you, you know. So, you know, as we go through our days, you know, remember, you know, this is an ugly thing. You're standing in front of me, but man, has he blessed me. He has blessed me with 80 years, wonderful wife, wonderful children, you know. How can I not praise him? I will praise him 464. Come on, folks, and let's sing a couple verses of this one, and then we'll turn Paul loose. 464. 464.
Brother Dave, to bring the prayer here for the offering today.
Dear God, our Heavenly Father, we come to you once again today. We're so thankful for another day of life that you blessed us with, so we can come together and hear your word proclaimed. And Father, we just pray that you be with those who are absent from us today. Father, especially those who are at Seedland, we just pray that you have your hand upon them and help them to grow in grace and knowledge of you, and just bring them home safely.
Amen.
After this, and Father, we just pray. Brother Paul, as he breaks the bread of life to us, to say, just to speak to us today, Father, just give him the words that will touch each and every heart here and draw us closer to you.
Amen.
If there's one here that doesn't know you, we just pray that today would be the day of their salvation. And now as we come to this time when we can give back a portion unto you as you blessed us with, we just pray that you bless the gift and the giver and use this offering for thy honor and for thy glory. We ask it in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Thank you. Nice job, ladies. Thank you. I looked over there at first, and I saw three legs below the piano and one head. I thought, Mona Ray, you're pretty good. You're like a magician over there. I'm going to sing Long Black Train. I think I did it not too long ago, but it kind of goes with the message today. How many of you have had to fight with the devil this week? I know I have. Well, we're going to expound upon the last message I brought and talk a little bit about the devil through history and what's going on today, and hopefully it'll speak to somebody's heart. There's a long black train coming down the line, feeding off the souls that are lost and crying. Rails of sin, only evil remains. Watch out, brother, for that long black train. You can look to the heavens, you can look to the sky. You can find redemption staring back into your eyes. There is protection and there's peace the same. Burn in your ticket for that long black train. 'Cause there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory in the Lord. Cling to the Father and His holy name, and don't go riding on that long black train. There's an engineer on that long black train, making you wonder if the ride is worth the pain. He's just a-waiting on your heart to say, let me ride on that long black train. 'Cause there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory in the Lord. Cling to the Father and His holy name, and don't go riding on that long black train. I can hear that whistle from a mile away. It sounds so good, but I must stay away. That train is a beauty, making everybody stare. But its only destination is the middle of nowhere. 'Cause there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory in the Lord. Cling to the Father and His holy name, and don't go riding on that long black train. I said, cling to the Father and His holy name, and don't go riding on that long black train. Yeah, watch out, brother, for that long black train. The devil's a-driving that long black train. I know the devil was fight me this week. And if you think about it, The devil's been fighting man since Adam and Eve. You know, so we're not unique if we find ourselves during the week having issues and feel like the devil's really trying to get us or get us down, or actually something comes up that we feel, you know, is taking us away from God, and it's an excuse, but we're using it because we're hurting or suffering. God's been doing, or the devil's been doing this to mankind since Adam and Eve were in the garden. We're going to talk about that a little bit today and expound upon some of the stuff that I talked about the last time I was here. I'm sure you can see I'm very passionate about getting each and every one of you out to vote. Amen. And trying to change the course of this country.
Amen.
Let's have a word of prayer before I get started. Dear Heavenly Father, please be with me as I bring the message today. Let it speak to people's hearts. Help there to be no error, Lord. Be with those again that are traveling over at Sea Lion, Pastor Diane and the others, and be with each and every person in here. I'm sure there's not one person in here that's not going through something in their life, Lord, that hasn't had something this past week or just over the last few months, maybe that's weighing us down, or we feel like we're just, you know, sometimes don't know how we're going to get through it. But we know that each and every one of us that know you as our Savior are just passing through. This is just a vapor, and that we'll be with you for eternity in heaven, and these things won't matter. Lord, just be with each and every one of us as we go through the week. Help us to have a strong testimony for you, Lord. And if there's one here today that doesn't know you as their Savior, let this be the day that they ask you into their heart, Lord. We ask this in thy Son's name. Amen. The devil was playing havoc with me this morning. Even you can hear my voice in and out, in and out. I woke up with a stuffy nose. I don't remember the last time I had a stuffy nose. It might have been years ago. I don't even remember. But I was practicing the song this morning, and my voice was cracking, going in and out. And I said, well, Alfalfa's back for singing today. I used to like to listen to the Little Rascals, watch Alfalfa sing to Darla. That was hilarious. My favorite episode, I don't know if you remember the one where they had the guy under the sun lamp and they were feeding him crackers, trying to get him to say something to kid, and wouldn't give him any water. Froggy was one of them, I remember. I don't remember the whole episode, but for some reason, I always remember that as a torture. We're going to give you crackers and no water. We're going to put you under the heat lamp. I don't know if you guys remember that one or not. Well, it seems, John said last time I forgot to do this, he was right. It didn't even cross my mind. So you see, I'm getting old now. I'm a grandpa, so I forget things. Well, it seems a Christian guy named Bill, and I'm not picking on Brother Bill Rittenour since I've known him so long, but this was who was in the joke. So it seems a Christian guy named Bill saw an online ad for a Christian horse. So he went to check it out. The horse's owner said, yeah, he's easy to ride. You just say, praise the Lord, and it'll make him go. And to make him stop, you just say, amen. Well, Bill got on the horse and he said, praise the Lord. And sure enough, the horse started to walk. Bill said, praise the Lord again. And the horse started to trot. Praise the Lord, Bill yelled. And the horse began to gallop. Bill was enjoying the ride so much that he almost didn't notice that there was a cliff coming up. And they got right up to the cliff and Bill shouted, amen. The horse stopped right at the edge of the cliff, relieved. Bill said, whew, praise the Lord. I've never been much of an animal person because I was always into sports. It just wasn't my thing. I mean, I didn't dislike them. But when I was little, we had horses when we moved out to Atwater. My sisters did. Funny how at 5 a.m. when they were loose out of the fence that I was the one that had to go out and help mom get them. And they weren't mine. But I remember I used to, I could see Shelly's back there. I can see her smirking because she remembers that. I used to fuss. I'm carrying 5-gallon buckets of water for an acre up to the thing to put them in for the horses. They're not my horses. Why am I doing this? I remember mom would just say, hey, just do what I ask you to do. And I did. But I hated getting up at 5 in the morning when they were loose out of the, before I had to go to school. I actually liked when, I didn't ride horses a lot, but I did like when I would ride the horses. The one we had was a real gentle Appaloosa named Duchess. And when she would gallop anywhere on her, it was pretty neat. It was so smooth. And if you've never ridden a horse, you don't know what I'm talking about. But if you have and you've been on one and it's been galloping, it was pretty neat. I did like that part of it. And we had her bred, and she had a little horse. We had a baby Appaloosa with a white blanket on its butt. It was beautiful. And I would lay down actually out in the pasture with my head right next to the little horse, and I would feed him food and stuff like that. And it was like I had a little dog out there laying with me. And I, even though they weren't mine, at times I found myself dealing with them and spending kind of precious moments like that with them. So you never know. Well, the current situation in the United States, you know, and in the world, it just can't be pleasing to God. The devil, he's having his way. He's having his way with the world. He's having his way with our country. He's having his way with our politicians and our people. You know, the devil started working on man from the beginning of mankind. When Adam and Eve were in the garden, and God would walk with them and talk with them in the mornings, you know, if they hadn't sinned, imagine what this world would be like. It would be heaven on earth. But the devil tempted Eve in the Garden of Eden, and Adam and Eve disobeyed God when they took of the forbidden fruit. So that was the first time that the devil was able to take mankind and make him go against God. Then shortly after, we know what happened with Adam and Eve's children. Cain slew Abel and committed the first murder ever in the history of the world. This was 6,000 years ago. 6,000 years ago when this happened. Then there was Noah, who came about 1,647 years later. Turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 17. Luke 17, we're going to look at verses 26 and 27. And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat and drink, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 6. Oh, and by the way, if anyone needs an ark, I happen to know a guy. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of his thoughts and of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast. Excuse me. And the creeping thing that and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations. And Noah walked with God, and Noah begat three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. And God said unto Noah, the end of the all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Well, we know the story of Noah as it goes on from there. He built an ark. How many of you have been over and visited the ark down in, I think it's in Kentucky? I was there with my mom before she passed away. Wow, amazing, amazing that a man could build that with the help of his sons. Just amazing how big that thing was, and just amazing to think about all the animals that were in there that God led in there so that he could preserve them. Well, we know that during the time of Noah, things were very violent. Man didn't have anything to do with God, basically. God was sorry that he made mankind, it says. And we know, we've studied, and I've heard it from up here with Harold, Brother Harold, with Pastor Bob. Why did God make us? For his pleasure. But God tells us that he was grieved in his heart. He was sorry that he made mankind. The earth was so wicked. Man was wicked. His thoughts were evil. The earth was filled with violence. But imagine how bad God must have felt for him to say, I've had enough. I'm going to destroy it. And we're starting over with Noah and his sons and their wives. Just really think about that for a second. God created man for his pleasure, Adam and Eve, and he sat there and he watched it for thousands of years, and then he was sick of mankind and what he was like. So he decided, I'm going to destroy it with a flood. And anybody that wants to get on the ark, I will preserve and save. God tells us that the last days would be perilous as they were in the days of Noah. During this time, during Noah's time, it's as if people were unaware of God. They were unaware of his intentions for man. They wouldn't listen to Noah over more than 100 years that it took him to build the ark when he tried to get them to repent and to start working for God. They all laughed at him. It had never rained. They thought he was an idiot. There was enough moisture. God allowed there to be enough moisture in the land because of the dew that was there every morning. It had never rained. So they thought he was crazy building this ark, spending all this time building this big ark. Rain? It's not going to rain. It never has rained. What are you talking about? Today, people are unaware of his return. And today, people are doing their own thing. They don't give much thought to God. During Noah's days, God gave man 120 years to change their minds. Even after he said that man's only thoughts were evil, and he was tired of them. And nobody but Noah's sons and himself would heed to God's word. They ignored God. Back then, they definitely weren't going to church. They definitely weren't going and listening to somebody speak about the Lord. When Noah would talk, they thought he was crazy. They ignored God because they were too busy doing the things on the earth that brought them pleasure. What does that sound like? Right now. It sounds exactly right now. 7 days a week right now, people are doing their own thing. I look around this church. At the congregation, there's all kinds of empty seats in these pews. I'm 58 years old. Raise your hand if you're younger than me. maybe a dozen. So I'm one of the younger people in the church, and I'm 58. That's happening everywhere. Everybody that I talk to, friends of mine that go to churches, it's happening everywhere. There's a falling away. I'd say 90% of the people that I talk to or run into contact with today, outside of Christians and outside of friends here in church, they have no clue what the Bible says. They have no clue that Jesus is going to return someday, and they have no clue of what it takes to get to heaven. Unless you hear somebody talk about the coming of the Lord, or you open God's word, you're not going to have a clue. So most people don't do those things today. What's that sound like? Sounds like the days of Noah. Turn in your Bibles to 2 Timothy. Let's look at 2 Timothy. We're going to look at chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 first. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers. Boy, that hits home with me with everything I see on TV. False accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Amen. I'm sure that's like it was in the days of Noah, and we know that's how it is today. People that don't have Christ in their heart, they don't know that that's how it is today. They think what's going on is what's going on. It's been going on and it's going to keep going on, and they don't give a second thought to God. It's all about pleasure for me. It's all about making sure I'm happy. It's all about me. It's all about me. It's all about me. That's what it's all about today. It's all about me. Let's look at chapter 4, verses 2 through 4. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. We're hearing more and more and more in today's society, not only about God being taken out of everything, but the stories of the Bible being fables. Yeah. Scientists supposedly disproving them.
Yeah, right.
Then you'll have, on the other hand, if you really research that and look at it, you'll have scientists that'll say, yeah, this happened. The earth was flooded. Yeah, those things did happen. It's kind of like the big climate change that's going on today. You got 1,000 scientists that say a bunch of malarkey, and then you got people that are saying it's going on today. What are you going to believe? Well, if you're not in God's word, you're going to believe the people that the climate change is a big thing. We got to take care of this, or volcanoes and oceans are going to devour us. Malarkey. We're spending billions of dollars on something that no other country is spending money on. Right. No major country is, because they don't believe in it. People are getting rich off of it in this country. Talked about Sodom and Gomorrah the last time I was up here. It's just 450 years later after Noah. We know that there was sexual immorality going on, lustful people, sexual behavior that was offensive to God during that time. God couldn't even find 10 righteous people in that city. He couldn't find 10 righteous people in that city. And I think that is kind of a mirror image of the way the world's going to be. We know how hard it is to get into heaven. The Bible tells us. However, if you take the time to learn how to get into heaven, you know that it's a free gift.
Amen.
It's a free gift from God. It's not rocket science, and it's not really that hard compared to the things we go through in our lives. You just got to believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is your Savior. You got to accept that, repent, and you are saved.
Amen.
And you spend eternity in heaven. And no man's going to take that from you. No man's going to pluck that from you. It's amazing how much violence has increased just in the last few years in this country. The murders, the things that are going on in this country. If you watch the news at night, I don't know how you don't get upset. Brother Harold talks about patience. He struggles with his patience, and he has over the years. I'm a type A personality. I have too. I've struggled my whole life with being a patient man. I'm on medication now, the maximum dose they can give me for this disease that I'm on. One of the side effects is it makes you angry and on edge. Combine that with lack of patience sometimes.
Right.
And I can be a bear to live with. Just ask April. My sister's seen it in me. My kids. But when I see stuff that's going on, it makes me want to defend people.
Yeah.
I've always wanted to be the person that would step in for the underdog or the people that were getting bullied. And stop it. I had a kid throw me up at the top of the locker one time in fifth grade. He was 3 years older than me, but he was in my class. Poor kid had moved around from place to place, and he was trying to pick on some people in class, and I got in between him, and I said, "You're not going to do it." He goes, "Well, what are you going to do about it?" I said, "I'm going to stop you." He picked me up, threw me up at the top of the lockers. I slid down the lockers, popped up. I said, "Is that all you got?" And when he left the class a few months later, because he was from class to class, came from a broken home, he said, "You're the only person that's ever stood up to me."
Amen.
And he said, "I respect you for that."
Wow.
I was watching the news the other night. You might have seen this. They showed the New York subway. They showed all these ladies dressed up with these stretchy green suits covering their face and on their body, literally going around robbing people on the subway and beating them up if they didn't give them their money and their purses. That made me want to be there and take care of those people.
Amen.
I was angry about it. I was thinking, I wish I was there. I would knock every, I don't care if they were women or not, I would knock them out. I saw another thing in New York a week or two ago where there was this lady, I think it was at the airport, walking by herself, and all of a sudden, a homeless guy comes up to her and starts to beat her up and assault her, threw her up against the wall, started kicking her. A guy comes through the turnstile to try go over to try to help, and the guy turns around and says something to him, and that guy takes off running. I wish I'd have been that guy, because he would have had to beat me up too, because I would have tried to lay him out, picking on that poor lady. She's just minding her own business. And the problem with all of that, besides it being horrible, is these people go in front of a judge now in this country, and they get released back into society, and they start doing it again. If you would have told me 10 years ago, 15, 20 years ago, that was going to happen before Christ came or in our lifetime, I would have said you're crazy. But the current people that are making decisions are allowing those things to happen. We have got to change it. We are still living on this earth, and Christ might not come back before all of us take our last breath. We've got to change it. Tuesday, November 8th is coming up. It's just around the corner. Don't sit at home and not go vote.
Right.
Go vote to change this.
Yes.
It just sickens me when I see the a poor lady, she goes out to run, and she gets abducted and raped and killed. And she's the mother of children, the wife of a husband. I think it could have been one of my kids. And I get mad. I want to rip somebody's head off. It sickens me that we have people that are making decisions in this country that are allowing this to happen. Get them out of here. And if you don't want to live in a godly society, go live in another country. Let's turn to 2 Peter. Let's look at 2 Peter chapter 2. We're going to look at verses 4 through 9. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that after should live ungodly, and delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelleth among them, and seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations, and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished.
Amen.
God has given us examples in the Bible of Noah, his time, Sodom and Gomorrah's time, yet even Adam and Eve, of the devil playing havoc in this world. And what he can do to you if you don't have the armor of God, if you don't have salvation, if you don't have the Lord as your Savior. And it can happen to us even if we do have those things in this world. But if it does and we take our last breath, we know the first thing we're going to do is wake up in heaven.
Amen.
Those people, 90% of the people in the world today don't know about this. Or if they've heard about it, they don't care. We need leaders that aren't afraid to speak about these things, the examples that God's given us, and the way the world is going, so that we can make a change. We know that in the last days there will be perilous times. We know that in the last days, these things that are happening now, the violence, the sexual immorality, the things that were there during Sodom and Gomorrah, the things that were there during Noah, we know that these things are going to happen. But we can't sit by idly on our hands and while we're on earth allow it to happen without saying something.
Amen.
We can't. We've got to speak up. We've got to ask for leaders that will put God first in this country.
Yes.
When I hear the people that are in power in this country speak nowadays, or if I see some of the ads of some of the people running, when do you ever hear God mentioned? You don't. I don't hear it come out of their lips. Don't be afraid to let others know what God's done for you. Don't be afraid to let others know that if we don't turn back to God, we can't change the course of this country. And I'm telling you right now, I know this as a former history teacher and person that studied politics, a person that studied government. If we don't change the course of this country in 2 weeks, we're done.
That's true.
We're done. We're never going to get it back.
Never.
Any person that you have that votes, that's a loved one that has the same beliefs that you do, if they can't get to the polls on November 8th, take them. Because we're not going to come back from a Congress that's of a political party that allows this stuff to happen and a president that allows this stuff to happen. We can't afford two more years of that in this country.
Amen.
If it happens, we'll never make it back.
Never.
And somebody might be walking in your house at night while you're sleeping, taking your things, and doing something to you or your loved one. And then they'll be back out on the street.
Yep.
Chapter 3, verses 3 and 4 in 2 Peter. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. These things are being turned into fables, as we've talked about already today. Where, yeah, God's coming back. Yeah, God. God wouldn't allow this to happen. God wouldn't allow all these things to happen. People don't understand the importance of God's word. So many people today go about their daily lives never thinking of God, not praying, not reading his word. Parents don't teach children about God. Look how many little ones we got in this church today.
Right.
And it's going on in all the churches around us.
Right.
Seems like 20 years ago, I remember when my kids were little, many young children in Sunday school classes. Our politicians today are liars, they're deceivers, they're ungodly. They're falling away from God. I read a statistic, if I can find it. 44 million children are being aborted every year. It's unbelievable what we listen to every day coming out of our leaders' mouths. You know, the devil has been tempting man, as I started this, by corrupting man and tempting him with these things, destroying man with evil thoughts, alcohol, perverse sexual behavior, wickedness, violence, disbelief, since Adam and Eve, since Noah, since Sodom and Gomorrah. Please, 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 please vote on November 8th. Please, please, please tell others about what God has done for you. Tell them how to get saved. Tell them what's going to happen if they don't get saved. And it's sometimes hardest with the people that are closest to us, because you don't want to have a relationship that is strained. But those people we want to see in heaven. So we've got to tell them. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
The devil is going to keep trying to separate us. He's going to keep trying to separate us as a people. We probably haven't been this divided since the Civil War. Some of you, many of you, I lived through it. A lot of the racial tension in this country in the 60s and the 70s, I was too little to really remember it, but I was here. But I've had a lot of people tell me it's worse now. Turn to Romans chapter 10. Adolph, if you'll come up, please, we'll get ready for the altar call here. If you have someone in your family that doesn't know Christ as their Savior, try to sit down with them sometime and open a Bible and turn to Romans chapter 10. If there's someone here today that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Savior, let's look at these words. that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth, I'm in verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and that shalt believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
And in verse 17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Folks, I feel like God has put me up here twice in the last couple weeks to try to motivate you to get out and vote.
Amen.
And talk to you about what's going on now, what's going on in the world, and don't be afraid to talk about it to others. I do not want to keep going through life with the current conditions.
No.
If it's going to stay this way and get worse, God, get us out of here.
Amen.
But if he's going to delay Christ coming back to this earth, and our kids and our grandkids are going to grow up in this world, our backs are up against the wall.
Yep. That's right.
We've got to fight. We've got to fight with God's word. And we've got to put people in office that aren't afraid to put God first and quit bending over to the minority opinion.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
And to the opinion of those that don't know the Lord and the opinion of those that are being run by the devil. I don't want to live in that world, and I don't want my kids and grandkids to live
Amen.
In that world. Adolf.
Thank you, Paul.